Well, good morning, good afternoon, good day, good night. See you later. No, we're just going to see you right now. We're just starting the thing. And it is, let's see what day it is. It is March 22nd, 2017. And it's amazing. We've made it this far together, if you're here. So congratulations, everybody being alive and kicking and on the weekly iAwake teleseminar. And we have with us today, well, Pam is here as for often, almost always. And we have Doug Prater. And Doug is well, you've been on the teleseminar. I actually interviewed you. We've had conversations right here, Doug.
Yeah, we did have a conversation a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, so good morning. So anyway, Doug, just want to introduce Doug again. And in the very rapidly Doug-year ambiance that is iAwake, we started, anyway, I became friends with Doug online and we started talking, and then we wanted to get the Integral Recovery podcast going. And I was saying, now who in the heck knows how to have all those skill sets? And I was going to put out a thing to our list, and I thought about Doug, and I said, well, maybe I should ask him. And it turns out Doug is multi-talented in so many ways. And we have started the IR, the Adventure of Integral Recovery podcast. And Doug is a producer and co-host along with me and Dr. Bob Weathers. And we've been having a rocking time. It's so much fun. And we're recording some more shows on this Saturday, and it's up. It's on iTunes. It's on Google.
Google Play. It's on Stitcher.
And Stitcher. So, and it's also at the Integral Recovery Institute website. So it's all over the place, and we're having a really good time. We've been getting out to lists, and people have been sharing it with folks, and so that's so great. It was a dream fulfilled, a vision fulfilled, to get that podcast going, and it is growing, and people are listening to it, so that's really rewarding. And then we started thinking, well, you know, he's done such a smash-up job with his podcast. Maybe we could, or I think it was Pam's, like, I want him for iAwake stuff too. So anyway, he's just been brought on board, and it's been really great to have your talent, Doug, and your insight, wisdom, heart, brain, skills, etc. So hi everybody, and this is the weekly teleseminar, and normally we just start out, you know, just saying a few things, and then we'll just open it up to conversations, questions, experiences you're having, any kind of technical questions you might have about using this technology as a transformational tool, or where to stick the little plug in the hole, or whatever, you know, no matter how sophisticated or how simple, it's all good. And this is being recorded, so be aware, if you're on this and you say something stupid, the whole world might be seeing it next week. So try to keep you know, we can edit this also. So anyway, we're gonna get rolling, and let's see. I did, we're having a product I've been testing out that's going to be coming out in the next few weeks. We have a number of things in the pipeline. We're coming out with NeuroHacks, which is really great. And it was something that we were going to, we kind of small released it back 2 or 3 years ago, calling it Digital Pills. And then we went back and said, wait a second, this really never got the kind of launch it deserved. It was great stuff. And we renamed it, NeuroHacks, and it is I can't even remember the new names. I think it's AM Wake Up. Is that the first one? So the 20-minute thing, like to get you going in the morning. Then there's a, what do we call it now, Pam? Help me out.
Recharge.
It was digital energy before, but it's something to use. You know, a lot of us hit that, you know, that 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock thing in the afternoon, and the energy goes down, and this is it's a 20-minute track to kind of get you back in, you know, back alert and at your best. And then we have the one for the evening, which is called
evening relaxation.
I think I came up with all these names, but it just shows you I don't remember. Just because I came up with it doesn't mean I know from moment to moment what the hell I said, but anyway, it. And then the one to get ready to go to sleep is Digital Dreams. So they're really cool, and
now it's called Dream Time,
right? Aboriginal kind of thing. Anyway, and we were like, you know, do we have any testimonials about this? So we put it out in the pipeline, and all of a sudden we get these great testimonials, people saying, yeah, this is fantastic stuff. We've been using it and love it. So it's a really good product. So that'll be coming out on Thursday, tomorrow. Yes, ma'am? So beware, you know, and that's just, it's so cool. And I have been working on this thing where I did a bundle of iAwake tracks. And I started out with, and you guys can try this on your own if you already own these tracks, we can get them. But anyway, started out with, from NeuroHacks, I did AM Wake Up and the Recharge, okay, 40 minutes. And then I did PMP 2, Level 2, Track 2 and Track 3, and then finished off with Deep Delta. So that's an hour of entrainment. And it is the most powerful entrainment experience I've ever had. And I've done long entrainments before. I've been
you
doing
mean 2 hours, right?
Did I say 3 hours?
You said an hour.
Well, excuse me. I was just making it easy for you guys to handle, but it's actually 2 hours. So it's amazing. And the first two kind of get you energized, you know, and you just kind of get in this zone and, you know, you can think and blah, 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 this is going on. And then you hit the PMP for 40 minutes and that takes it. And then by the time you get over an hour, about an hour and five, hour and 10, hour and 20 minutes, man, it just, and you go into Deep Delta, it's really something. Very, very powerful. And go into this kind of deep samadhi state, you know, where you're just, you know, the old Zen thing, the Zen koan, body drop, mind drop, you know, that sometimes that just the awareness of individual ego or body just kind of goes and you're just in this space of profound stillness and fecundity. And so it's really, really powerful. And we're talking about today that maybe we're going to release it as a streaming thing for a couple of weeks where people can go and try it out. Then if they want it, they can buy it. But just to let them know, this is hardcore stuff. This is not beginner stuff. This is not for the people who just want to meditate 20 minutes a day. This is for people who really want to take it to a deep level. And I don't think it's appropriate for every day because it's really, really strong. But I do think it might be appropriate for, you know, intermediate advanced meditators once a week. Or also if you're initiating a new project or a transition in your life, you know, and it's really great because you get to this place where you really get into that zone of deep insight, you know, and not just mental activity, but that where the wisdom voice or as Dr. Deborah Rossman calls heart intelligence, that place where the intuitive voice really speaks to you in profound ways. And that's really, it's really good, you know, because we can do all the mental work, you know, intellectual work, which is great stuff. I'm not anti-intellectual or anti-mind at all, but it has its purposes. It's good for some things and not for others. But for these deeper, insightful, vocational, directional, tactical and strategic life directional things, it's really, really good. And I think when you do it, say you do it on a Saturday or Sunday, kind of ending the week and getting ready for the next cycle, you'll find that this is what I've been finding anyway. We find that your next meditation, even if it's not really long, it's your average, your normal meditation is better because you really push yourself. So we're pretty excited about that. We also have coming out from our brilliant colleague and friend in Berlin, Nadja Lin, and she's coming out with a second workout ecstasy track. And if you guys work out, good for you. And if you don't, shame on you. I want you to feel really bad and start doing it. So kind of kidding. Now, anyway, it trains you to, I believe it's alpha or alpha theta. And Nadja is a world-class trance electronic music producer. She travels all over the world and does these big parties in the Middle East and Ibiza and Australia, and even did it here in Teesdale, Utah one time. My goodness, that's big time. And anyway, she's really brilliant producer, and she's a you know, lifelong, not a lifelong, but in the last long time, she's been meditating, producing brain and train material, and a real gym rat. You know, every time I'm in Berlin, I stay with her and we hit the gym, you know, every day with a lot of fun. So anyway, that's coming around, and Yeah, and one thing I wanted to share, I kind of, you know, the morning before we do the teleseminar, I said, well, is there anything I'm supposed to be talking about or share? And I'll just briefly say this. When I was meditating this morning and I was in that deep, empty place, spaciousness, peaceful, blissful, samadhi-ish or samadhi-it place that you get in meditation, I recalled, it was a book by Deepak Chopra. And at the time, I was kind of, my projections about Deepak Chopra, because he was really successful and, you know, talking about spirituality, and that was somehow, you know, it's better to be poor and talk about spiritual. Anyway, I don't know. But I opened the book and it just fell on this passage, and he was talking about when you get into this deep place where it starts to be unitive, where it's supposed to start to be non-dual, where you're just in this presence, okay, that you kind of purify your ego stuff, like, Lord, you know, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz or whatever your trip is, and you get under that or leave that behind. Then there's kind of a sacred, very pure, intentional thing that you can put out, like, you know, I really want to, you know, help the world do this or something. It's like in that stillness, you put it in there and it just kind of ripples out, and it actually begins to affect your inner world and outer world, and things begin, and that's when synchronicities and stuff start to happen. And I've experienced that over, you know, the last few years when in deep meditation. And, you know, I'm not trying to put it out as like the secret sort of thing, but I do think when we're truly in deep alignment in our interior work and interior practice, that it just shifts everything. For one thing, we can connect with people in a way that we can't normally connect. You know, so you walk into a room and guys depressed, you know, you feel it. You know, you walk into somebody being compassionate and open and real and walking integrity or coming from the, you know, their heart in a deep way, you feel it and things begin to shift. So anyway, I just want to say that it's important that we train ourselves and that we have the technologies that really help us do that. Now, but we get to those deep places and we cultivate that, because that's places where our own inner wounds and our own stuff begins to kind of loosen up and dissolve and release. And it's a place where we find meaning and purpose. And it's a place where some really kind of amazing things begin to happen. And lately around here, I think the connections in the exterior world, it's like we're riding this wave of just amazing people and things and events happening. And it really feels like something's going on, you know, like, at times they are changing, the wave, it is arising, and things are in the high zone. So it's up to us to work on ourselves as much as possible so that we're, you know, good vehicles, good surfers, if you will, and get our stuff out of the way, our petty stuff, our non-noble stuff, if you will, and get our egos and get in there with open hearts and open minds and be channels of this thing that's come through right now. So I think that's about all I want to say right now. So Doug or anybody else would like to ask questions or say anything or make comments, it's all good.
I had a quick question for you, John, about this Riding the Dragon meditation that you've been doing. It just sounds fascinating, and I'm so eager to try it. I'm really excited that it's going to be available for streaming, and think that'll be good for everyone. But I wondered if there is any particular meditation practice that you recommend to go along with it.
That's a great one. You know, in the first part, in my meditation, it often feels like kind of like an archaeological psychic dig. You know, I start off here like, I got my coffee, and I do have a notebook. Where's my pen? If something important comes up, and the cushion, right? Blah blah. And so I get through all that, and then there'll be some thinking about this and that, and then into about, you know, when it gets into about 50 minutes or so, my meditation is a centering meditation where I focus on the heart. You know, and I know that's causing a congruence between the brain and the heart, and there's so much science out there right now that this congruence is in these states where both brain and heart are balanced out and kind of resonating at the same frequency is very, very important. So this comes from an ancient Christian type of meditation that I discovered on my own, and later on I found it there was a ancient history of it. Basically, you soak, focus on your heart center, and little prayers, you know, spirit, divinity, whatever, I'm whoever, whatever you name that. So what I'm trying to say is, like, you know, I'm requesting your presence. I really need your presence right here, and I'm waiting. And then you just focus, and if your mind wanders, which it will, just have a word that comes back to center. You know, it's like, thank you, or amen, or, you know, zoom, zoom. And then after a while, it's just like, you're in this deep contemplative place. And when I say contemplative, means you are in that mysterious divine presence, and there you are. And at that point, you can experience as a oneness, or you can experience it as a, you know, your second person, that you're dealing with the divine other, you know, that's all through you. Or it's, anyway, the words begin to kind of break down. Read Rumi, if this makes no sense. He does a lot better job of languaging all this stuff. So yeah, does that help? Does that answer the question, Doug?
Yeah, that actually helps quite a bit. I've been exploring a little bit, not with the same centering meditation, but in my own meta practice, and have found that it has made a big difference too in my ability to connect with others and feel what's going on. So I certainly look forward to trying that too while I'm experimenting with riding the dragon.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have an easier one that is a 5-minute meditation. It's called sitting on the mouse. So for you guys that don't really work that hard, sitting on the mouse. Anyway.
Okay.
Okay.
So I just want to invite, if other people are on here and they want to comment, you can either raise your hand, there's a way to do that, or you can just unmute yourself. And then if you're on the phone, hit the *6. And Matt will unmute you. He'll also mute you. Yes, go ahead, Garrett. Garrett, can you unmute yourself? You want me to do it? Yeah, okay. Can't hear you, Garrett.
Garrett, do you hear me?
You are unmuted, so we should be able to hear you. Nope. Darn. Do you want to just try typing in the chat your question, maybe, and we can do it that way? Maybe while you're doing that, I'll just say a couple of other news things. So we've been working on the spiritual technologies interviews. We're almost done. And we've been covering kind of the latest spiritual technologies that are coming online, vibration chairs, apps, microdosing, LSD and mushrooms, community platforms, Dave Asprey of Bulletproof, he's the quintessential biohacker, and we had a really cool panel on what are spiritual technologies.
And last but not least, we just did Mina Lee this morning, and she is Mikey Siegel's partner, who's been, you know, a leader in this kind of neuro hacking field, biohacking field. And she was brilliant. Oh my gosh. You know, really, really wonderful conversation, and talking about the need of the importance of community. Well, she's talked about a lot of things, but, you know, we need to online and offline this stuff. You know, it's not enough just to be online anymore, because we need, although, you know, this is fantastic that we're able to talk to each other from all over the world like this. We need to, you know, we need community. And it's very important, especially if we're really aspiring to do, you know, important stuff, or transform ourselves, or become more spiritual, or more compassionate, intelligent, whatever it is we're working on. We need to hang out. And they're working on that. And we need to do, I think we need to do a better job. And we're actually working on that also. Pam and I will be going to California. We're driving there from Utah, but we're leaving on the 31st or something like that, and next Friday. And we'll be going to California and meeting up with a spiritual teacher and community builder, Bite Lindau. I got that right. and from the Human Trust community in Germany. And they've done a fantastic job, and it's exploding over there. And so they wanted to use iAwake in their community. So I said, and they were telling me about what they're doing. I said, well, we need a platform like that over here. So he's coming over, and we're going to be traveling through California and meeting up with a lot of writers and authors and kind of the consciousness leader types. And so that should be really, really interesting. And, you know, in the same time that we've been talking with Bite about that, this whole thing is like emerging independently right at the same time. It's like mushrooms are coming up all over the forest. So there's something going on here. It's all connected. You know, mushrooms are connected with these rhizomes that go off all over the place. So that's really exciting. And when I start seeing that, it makes me think I'm part of something bigger than just the individual project. And so hopefully we can start blending these efforts and come together and do some really great things. And here I am talking again.
Yeah,
so,
hey, listen, Garrick, David, I see you posted first, but I'm going to do Garrick since he was trying to talk first. So Garrick says, I think this was already addressed, but here goes. I've been using PMP again for a couple of weeks with a variety of positive results, particularly in the area of fatigue. I've been on disability for multiple sclerosis for 7 years, and pervasive fatigue is my most debilitating symptom. So I have been thinking of adding the deep delta track. Should I be concerned about the slightly higher delta frequencies in that track stepping on the results of the PMP?
May I speak to that? In my experience, these tracks, they work wonderfully together. And part of my practice now is I mix and match intuitively the ones that I think will work. And I've never had a train wreck yet. I'm like, oh, I just went from, you know, alpha, boom, to epsilon, and my whole brain melted. It doesn't really happen. They do seem to work on each other. And I think deep deltas be a great track for you, just because it's a wonderful train track. It's very powerful. But I think in these periods and these really when we're going through fatigue and chronic fatigue and this, which I've also experienced, that allowing yourself just to go deeply relaxing into this. And if you feel really tired when you're doing the meditation, I encourage you to put a cushion under your head, stretch out, do the old corpse pose in yoga, and train that, do the meditation that way. That's really, really good. And I think the deep, deep relaxed states that we achieved down there really helped us to come back in a more energized way. So I think you're right. You're in a really good path there. And I think, man, and let us know how it goes, but I think it's a really good idea.
Cool. And then David says, I don't know if it's my spiritual superego, but all these products and technologies from iAwake and a few other places have made this work feel easy. Almost too easy. I spent over a decade doing dozens and dozens of psycho-meditative somatic practices with intense effort. Something in me keeps feeling that this work should be hard still, and I shouldn't just be given deep states without intense effort on my part. I believe that this work must be democratized so that humanity doesn't destroy itself, but personally I can't shake this feeling that I should just be able to do it on my own.
So were you Catholic or Jewish or Southern Baptist? Where did you get all this shame from? No, I hear you. There's a, what's that?
Lutheran.
Oh my goodness, there you have it.
Moderate, ELCA, the moderate Lutherans.
You know, and I don't think it's completely easy, although, I mean, God, these tools are so amazing. They give us like you said, it democratizes this thing. We can all start showing up, waking up, growing up, cleaning up, and changing the world as we change ourselves. But I think it's still a hero's journey, you know, and just because, you know, if you've ever done games, you know, the hero keeps getting super bows or new superpowers and stuff like that. And it doesn't mean the game gets any easier. It's just that you have expanded capacities. So I don't think we should feel guilty about that. I think you should feel guilty. I don't know if I need to give a Lutheran more guilt. But, you know, it's like if you're not giving your gifts away, if you're not showing up and really actualizing and being your best self, because ultimately that's the gift that we have to give back to the world, right? And, you know, use it with wisdom and gratitude and with diligence and heroic, noble intentions, and you'll do great things, and it's okay.
It helps. It's almost like, I mean, it's my time in the Gurdjieff work where that all they say is, like, this work is extremely difficult and almost no one completes it, and maybe I was reinforced too much, or the effort I used to have to exert. It's it's like, it's given me more capacity to do the work itself, meditate, be self-observation of everyday life. So every practice I've always done works like significantly better. I mean,
it's so cool. Yeah.
It's still the effort, but, and I, to me, my criteria for all these technologies to be in a way that helps humanity is you should be able to, in a thought experiment, you know, be there changing your child's diapers in your everyday life or whatever, working career, and be able to awaken.
Absolutely.
Remove oneself from the world. So that's my criteria. So.
No, that's, and that is, I think that is the meta criteria, because it's really important, because most of us are not going to live monastic lives.
No.
You know?
No.
And a lot of the monasteries I've been to, you know, we have all these projections about how cool monasteries are and everybody's so enlightened and spiritual. Not so much,
no,
you know,
people.
I think the waking up's happening by and large outside of monasteries these days. Mm-hmm. So
this is a feeling I'm working with, just trying to gain insight into.
No, I love it. Can you stay awake while you're changing a diaper? That's a really good test.
Yeah, that's a thought experiment I've always said. I don't have kids, but if I do, you know.
Yeah.
You don't have time to meditate when you have kids for the most part.
Well, thank you, David. Cool. Yeah. So did that help? I mean, did we kind of deepen and make it okay for DBDs and stuff? And the thing is, you know, it's like our generations have been gifted with this stuff, and, you know, noblesse oblige, you know, we've got this stuff. And so let's really use it wisely and from a really noble intention, and we will go get deeper and better and more loving and more humble and more creative and more beautiful. Even though we're already beautiful, it'll just be more obvious.
I had a psychotherapy client who I hadn't seen in a few months, dropped out, went to another therapist and came back to me. She ended up using the free tracks, the free iAwake tracks, and it ended up being like a habit at night. Every night she listens to them. And she came back to me just transformed. I mean, she's low income, low self-soothing skills and all that. Just came back great, feeling religious, spiritual, and just, it was amazing to see. So,
isn't that something?
I think the tracks played a lot into it.
And do you notice your own abilities as a psychotherapist are improving, that you're more empathetic, more intuitive?
Oh yeah.
It's crazy.
It's like I see the person in HD almost. Like, that's what the delta's starting to do, curiously. It's like perceptions are heightened, and not just gamma, delta's doing that for some reason. So
yeah. And I think we've been talking about this, you know, but it's not just, oh, you want to do theta. Theta is the level that deals with emotional release or this and that. I think when you're using these tracks, the whole brain is starting just to function at a higher level. So it's not like you're just training for one thing. You're training your brain to react at an optimal for everything. So using all the different brainwave the meditations together really gets the brain going. And I noticed in my coaching career, when I was working with people online, that stuff kind of got scary. I would say, you know, I just got this image of this. And he goes, that was my dream last night. You know, just this like crazy-ass stuff started happening.
Huge amount of intuitive, you know, my therapy is like almost, it works when you're almost like a state of like almost mutual samadhi, and that's happened easier, but like these things are coming into me, so this intuitive felt sense or images and their thoughts, and it's like just what they were feeling or thinking, and it accelerates the therapy, so.
Hey, do you do all in person, or do you do online?
Some of my calls are online. I prefer in person, but someday when I figure out the logistics, Zoom is the best way to do it. I'm probably move a little bit into that.
Yeah, I think you'll find that it works much better than you would think possible, you know, because there is, and especially when we're doing this, you know, this type of practice, there's just this non-local thing that happens, and you just, you know, there's a connection across continents or oceans. Pretty cool. And it also expands, you're able to, I mean, we live in the middle of nowhere, you know, we'd never talk to anybody if it wasn't for, you know, the internet. So it's really wonderful how we can connect like this.
Yeah. Like I feel connected to iAwake and some other from afar. So great.
Thank you, David. That's awesome.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Comments, questions? Jokes? I got a joke. Okay. This is a personal joke, so you can blame me if you don't think it's funny. But, and you kind of have to be a guitar player maybe to understand this. But anyway, why was Jimi Hendrix's musical career like a car wreck? And you guys already heard, don't say it. because he was a fender bender. I'm just saying, the fruits of practice right there encapsulated. Anyway, I don't know if it's that funny or not. But anyway, so do we have other questions? A question, has anyone finished the PMP? How long did it take? My goodness. No, I don't know if it's, there's a, I never thought of it as something you you begin and finish. It's just an ongoing tool. Like, have you finished with the gym yet? Well, no, you just keep working out over your lifetime. And although I do mix and match, as I was talking about earlier, you know, a lot of different tracks. And I think after you've been doing this for a while, maybe a few months or so, you'll start kind of intuitively knowing, you know, before you meditate, you kind of check in and go, okay, what am I doing today? Oh yeah. And there it is. And you do, that's the practice you use.
I found that the slightly different frequencies between PMP and the Deep Delta, actually entrain a little bit better to one or the other, depending on the day and depending upon what's going on, other things in my state that influence that. And so they, yeah, seem to complement one another really well. It's worth playing with to experiment there. Also wanted to riff, John, on what you were saying earlier with training all the various frequencies of the rain, because you're never exhibiting just one in isolation. You look at a graph of an EEG and you have varying degrees of all of these things. So by training all the different frequencies, optimizing them all, you just tend to function better holistically in the long run.
Yeah, you know, in a book that we've been reading, it's that Doug actually turned me on to, it's called Stealing Fire, Kohut and Wheeler, I think. Is that the names of the author? I always get the guy Kohut wrong.
It's Kotler. And Wheel. Yeah.
Kotler, and it's not Wheeler, it's Wheel. Okay, Kotler and Wheel. Sorry, you guys, if you're out watching this. Anyway, it takes me a while. It's a fascinating book. It's kind of this almost encyclopedic scan over what people are doing, both in the corporate world, out of the corporate world, Navy SEALs, to train the body and the brain to be able to go into these flow states where, you're just functioning at a super high level. And David, I think that's what we were, talking about, you know, what's happening in your therapy practice. David, let me just see the back of your head. Oh, there you are again. So anyway, and what I found is that, and maybe I want to Jamie Wheel, right? I'm gonna contact him and say, you know, this is what I've been finding, that I don't think you have to have a single track to put you in, you know, the brain waves of flow. You have to have a brain that's been, you know, going through the workouts that Doug was describing, so that when you don't need to be in flow all the time. You know, when you're meditating, you don't want to be in a flow state. You know, you want to be in an empty state, a receptive state. But when you are called to be in a flow state, it's there. You know, like whether you're playing the guitar or teaching or talking or doing therapy, changing diapers would be an excellent place to go into a flow state. You know, whatever, or editing or whatever, you know, your work, your job is. And the flow state, I'll quote from the book. They have a acronym. It's STER, STER. And you guys will relate to this if you've been using iAwake for a while or just beginning even. The S is for selflessness. You know, the sense of self kind of gets out of the way and you're just, you know, you're tapped into this bigger source. T is there's a timelessness. You get into this zone and it's like, you know, you've been talking to your client for 50 minutes and it seems like 10 or something like that. And then there's an effortlessness. It's like it just comes through. You feel like you're an instrument or a channel, or the Native American elders say an empty bone, where the life just flows through, the medicine flows through, the healing flows through. And the last one, there's a richness. There's a deep wisdom that comes from it. Like it seems to be that the frontal lobe seemed to kind of be relaxing for a bit, and all the knowledge you've accumulated from whatever sources seems to be available. But not only is it just a random data dump, it connects the dots in new and inspiring and unique creative ways that happen to be very useful. So these are what people are looking for now, because we realize we live in such complicated, difficult times. I mean, God, just to have a house and pay your bills and raise a kid, you know, my God, and the society we live in and have, you know, have medical care and all this stuff, it takes an incredible amount of ability. So we need these super states, not all the time. You know, you don't want to walk around like you're on meth all the time or, you know, 24-hour flow state, but when it needs to be there, it is there. And I just had an interview with Arjuna Arda, the author of Translucent Revolution, one of my favorite books. And he's talking about there's a cycle, you know, you go from emptiness to flow to just getting it out there, doing the work. And then you go back to kind of fall, the leaves fall, and you kind of, it all goes away. Then you go back to emptiness and the cycle starts over. So it's all, you know, we can look at it that way. I think it's very useful. So we don't get attached. You know, I want to be in flow all the time. Well, that's not what you're supposed to do. It's part of a cycle that goes on in consciousness. If we train ourselves to that, we'll be doing very well. So.
Yeah, that principle is reflected in nature too, through the seasons, through night and day. Trying to be in flow all the time, you quickly deplete your supply of neurotransmitters too, and all that needs to be replenished. So that's definitely important to keep in mind as well. You don't want to be out there in the world in non-duality conscious all the time. That's not very helpful when you're driving down the freeway. But like you said, accessing when it is the right time for that is an incredible gift and one that's worth doing. I also think that accessing the ease with which all these technologies that are coming online now allow us to access those states is incredibly important, not cheating in the least, because we need, as we move forward into an uncertain future, to get people who have the power to shape our collective destiny as a species, as a world, as a cosmic consciousness on board with this stuff, and technologies that will help them do that, that bypass the 40 years of practice that some people historically would go through and still never reach, is one of the only solutions that I see long-term moving forward. I think it's a beautiful and brilliant thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Doug. Anybody else, questions, comments? Oh, I asked the same thing in the past. What happens when you adapt to third tier tracks? Well, you're a brainwave badass.
You are a master.
Well, absolutely, you know. And what is a master? A master is somebody who sticks with the practice. You know, you read the book Mastery by George Leonard, one of my favorite books. It's a classic little short book. It talks about what makes a master. Somebody just sticks with it. And I use PMP3 quite often, but you know, when I was doing the riding the dragon thing, I did tier two, two and three. I didn't do a tier three, two and three. And I tried that one time and it was just too much. You know, if you add that on to the end of a long meditation, you know, it's like, it's really powerful. It's like, it's almost too much. So yeah, you really need to kind of work with that and use it. And if you, and you can also, walk away from it and just do some other stuff, you know? And I found that because we have this kind of big gym, if you will, now we have all these different tracks. When you go back to, you know, you haven't used the, I don't know, the curling machine for a while, but you go back and it's like, oh, you have a new relationship with it, because, you know, as the Zenny say, that you can't step in the same river twice. So if you're kind of plateauing with one track, you might try something else and just kind of mix it up. But then again, plateauing is part of the path of mastery and accepting those times when you're not getting, you know, huge breakthroughs and everything. Because sometimes we go to a different stage and we have to do some kind of horizontal integration for a while until we get the next word or the next leap up. And you kind of have to fall in love as a master with the plateaus and with the valleys even, and then with the, you know, those kind of vertical evolutionary jumps, if you will. Or horizontal, no, vertical, sorry. Does that sound good? Yeah.
I think the integration period is extremely important. I've always come from paths that looked at, like, diamond approach and Gurdjieff work, that looked at everyday life as being more important than formal practice. Like, you learn about yourself from your life, but then you do formal practice to accelerate that. And So it's like after I do a lot of, I'm really focusing on the sine wave analogy because if I don't, I have these days or periods where I feel like, I feel like emotionally I can't deal with anything. I'm stressed and just something doesn't feel right. And then I stop doing everything. And then like, suddenly I'm like flow state right there, like really deeper than ever. It's like, oh, I need to integrate all. That's it.
That's really good. Yeah.
Too much input, you know?
Well, you know, it's the same thing with physical training. You know, I mean, if I have a good gym near me, which I don't, where I live in Iceland, well, sorry for the person who owns a local gym, but it's not a great gym. But anyway, I will tend to work out every day. And then, you know, you get a cold or something like that, and you don't work out for 4 days or a week, and you come back and you're stronger than when you stop because your muscles have had a chance to recharge. So there's something, I think there's something really to be said for that. So it's kind of finding your own way, you know. So you might want to, you know, I think meditation is great every day, but you might want to do some meditation interspersed with non-entrainment meditation.
Yeah, and, even the energy stuff causes the same thing. It's like you're too much input of something. It needs to be integrated.
Well, that's what it feels like when you use tier two, three too much. It's like it's too much. You know, it's like this is right. This is heavy lifting here. You want to, and of course, in working out, the rest time is just as important as the time in the gym, because if you don't do both, it's just the process is not going to work.
I've made this analogy before on the web, on the Facebook page. I focus more on really short and intense training. And what I've always learned from high intensity, like interval training, is that there's an inverse ratio. I'm not good at equations in math, between intensity of working out and need for recovery. So if you're sprinting, you only need to sprint once, twice a week. But if you're just slow aerobics, you can do that almost every day. And it seems the same thing for some of this stuff, especially if we have more sensitive nervous systems. Like it's almost like sprinting, meditating, and that needs much more recovery time, and to respect that.
Yeah,
that's how my nervous system seems to function.
Well, I used to use the analogy of scuba diving. You know, so in scuba diving, you go really deep. You know, things start happening with the blood and nitrogen mix and everything. And when you come up, you need to spend more time out of the deep water. And so, yeah, a lot of time we need just time to assimilate. And I think as we become more dialed into and sensitive to our subtle energy and interior process, we kind of know, you know, when it's the ego just saying, I'm going to listen to, you know, tier three for 8 hours and just break on through to the other side or something like that. You learn to kind of, you know, sense it, just like a highly trained athlete begins to know their body really well. And they know when it's time to knock off, and they know when they need to eat protein, and they know to, you know, it's part of the
listening to that.
Yeah.
I'll stop talking.
Yeah, interspersing the releasing tracks has been really helpful for me too. That's another good way to rest and recover and integrate some of that stuff that comes up when you get into a real deep delta kind of place. There's also one, I think it's it might be in the NeuroFlow series, the relax one, that is just lighter and easier to do and a good way to recharge, where you're not doing that same level of intense deep work that still allows you to meditate and get the refreshing recharging integration there on a level that is much more forgiving and easier to work with.
Yeah, so maybe we'll come out, like I was saying earlier, instead of riding the dragon, we'll come out with a sitting on the mouse, you know, for just those days when you don't want to sit on, when you don't want to lasso a dragon and ride it, you know. So that made sense in my very strange brain. But anyway, any other questions or comments, announcements, any old thing, and anybody who hasn't said anything is certainly welcome to do it.
I just posted in I asked a question about how do you use tracks when you're at work or working or studying. My brother Ward is actually building out kind of a focus on more of the corporate environment. So he's asking me. So I thought I would just put that out there. I'm just sort of curious, you know, do you use tracks for work? If you do, you know, what works? How do you use them? That kind of thing. I see Taya put in there. David put in, I put on certain tracks or energy between clients, listen to Neurocharger, Flow State, or Spark in the morning on long work days. Taya says, yeah, spark two, and a huge thanks for pointing us to Tom Bilyeu's interview with Jamie. Yeah. Interview with Jamie Wheel, time bending. Is that the impact one, Taya? I think that's the impact one, right?
God, I love that.
Yeah, we talked about it last week.
And you know, the last 5 or 10 minutes, Jamie is just in the zone, baby. He is prophesying, or he's in the flow state. And what he's saying was really not in the book. I mean, I still have a couple of chapters to read, but I've read the end. I don't think it's in there, but he was just present in the moment, putting it out there. And I wanted to cry. I wanted to cheer. So I don't know. Can we put that link up there, Pam, for people to do this? And I think you, at the end, he really summarized, you know, it's not flow states for flow states. Not like we just want to get high because flow states are groovy and they feel great, which they do. But we want to do that because it's our way for us to show up and be of greater service and create beautiful things and get more done, things that matter. And we do it out of deep love and deep compassion and also gratitude and humility. He really summed it up really beautifully there. Yeah, check it out. Check it out. And he's kind of an amazing guy. He was one of the first book that they did was called The Rise of the Superman. It was talking about extreme athletes, you know, when you put on these little flappy bat suits and jump off a 50-story building in downtown Manhattan, you get into a flow state real quick, you know. And people became addicted to that. And the only way they knew how to achieve that was doing these really crazy ass things. And obviously it's dangerous, you know, and if you have a family and kids and responsibilities, you may not want to, you know, splatter yourself all over the Manhattan sidewalk. And so they had to, you know, start coming up with different ways. And when we first moved to Moab, I had a friend, Kyle, what was his name? Kyle Copeland, who's passed away, but he was one of the top technical climbers in the world and did lots of the first climbs around Moab and stuff. And he was connected to these extreme climbers and athletes all over the world. And we'd be hanging out. He'd keep getting phone calls. Friends of his were dying, you know, because they were pushing it. And when you push it to those levels in these extreme things, you do get into a zone that is amazing. But there are other healthier ways, and maybe ways that are even more oriented to helping others in service than just, you know, putting yourself in these extreme situations. And that can only go on for so long, you know, then it's time you kind of have to back off. So anyway, The Rise of Superman is a really interesting book too. And Stealing Fire is probably more right now and useful in a lot of ways.
I was just thinking about, I was typing this to somebody, but David Asprey was also pointing out that service is a very powerful way to, you know, move into flow quickly. And I've certainly experienced that myself.
Yeah. Again, you know, service is like anything else, you know, you have to work on yourself to be of service. And if you don't, you get burnt out and fried really quick. You know, and I worked in the addiction field for a long time, and I found it myself and, you know, coworkers, people working the field, because there's so much trauma and there's so much stress and suffering in the families and the individuals, that if you don't have a practice, you don't take care of yourself, then a place of self-renewing where you can actually work from a level that's beyond just your ego stuff, you'll crash and burn really quickly. So flow can get you, service can get you in flow, but you better have something, a renewing self-care thing, because if not, you'll just be part of the bigger problem, and you will get discouraged and depressed and cynical and despair, et cetera. It's not a good place. Sonst noch was?
Using extreme sports, for example, to get into a flow state, you may wonder, how does that benefit the world? We're talking about using flow states to get our best work out into the world and be of service and benefit others. And how does participating in extreme sports help that? Who does that benefit? For one thing, I think that it can be incredibly inspiring and empowering to people to watch. But for another thing, the benefit you get from those states has a profound effect on increasing the levels of happiness and connection when you leave that activity and go back into your daily life. You were talking about the importance of recharging and dealing with the things that come up so that you can be of better service and pursuing flow states through activities like that, or through playing music, even if you're not a professional musician, whatever your method is of inducing flow can be just profoundly recharging in keeping you engaged with the work that you are doing so that you can be of service when you're needed.
Yeah. And almost all of the really high level climbers that I've known quite a few, talk about their climbing experience as being extreme spiritual experience. You know, you get up there and you're just like, there's 5,000 foot drop and you got this one handhold here and then another. It tends to focus the mind. And of course you bring that back into the world. I mean, you know, when you're, I was a wilderness guide doing all kinds of funky things and climbing up and down mountains with people and doing all this stuff. And I found that, wow, I'm pretty tough, you know, and that can, you know, it can give you the courage and strength. A lot of virtues, a lot of good things that you can develop doing these things is really, really translatable into the rest of your world. So I'm sorry if I was banging on extreme sports for a while. Anyway, I didn't mean to, but yeah, thanks, Doug.
Yeah, I didn't think you were bagging on it at all. I just wanted to add a little bit.
No,
I think there's really something too to confronting being so close to death, to confronting your own mortality in that way. When you're jumping out of an airplane or hanging from the cliff face of a rock, you are right there with the truth. And that can be profoundly transformative. And like you said, you bring it back with you.
Yeah, you know, and we were talking about David in these states, you know, you start to see things and perceive things. And I've noticed sometimes I'll be driving and there's a car, you know, 150 yards down the, and I said, that guy's going to pull out in front of me. I just knew it. So I already adapted to it. I was ready for it. He did. I made the next necessary move. And so instead of just getting all shaken up, oh, I could have died and everything, I was like, hey, there it was. You know, I was ready. I knew what to do and it just happened. So these kind of mini psychic things. And that's one of the things they talk about in The Rise of Superman, is that you begin to, time does weird things and you can actually see little things into the future, you know, because things are going so fast that the just your normal mind can't calculate all this stuff and do the trigonometry and know everything that you're supposed to do. And so it's just, man, you just know it before and you're already reacting. And I think all of us who have been, you know, interested in sports or athletes or worked at it, know those times that we get into the zone. You know, it's just fantastic. We are strangely and mysteriously made, and these tools are helping us to access these things that maybe were only available to very advanced yogis, or, you know, extremely strange or rare incidences are starting to come in line for a lot of us, you know. Pretty cool. Well, anything else? It looks like it's about time to wrap this up. It's so great being with you guys. Thank you so much. And thank you, Doug. Really appreciate you and Pam, of course, and all of you have been here and been participating in this. And we're going to try to, you know, get this into the podcast zone in the near future. And yeah, and we're going to be gone for a while, but who knows? I will check in, or, you know, Doug, yeah, you want to carry on with this while we're gone if I can't be there in a certain day, so we can keep this going. I think it'd be really useful.
We'll be here next week, but then we won't be here the 2 weeks after that.
Yeah, and I have this great ambition to do like a video blog, you know, with all these different people that we'd be meeting. So we'll see how that goes. And so anyway, keep practicing, all right? And be kind to yourself. And find somebody you really would normally ignore and send them, you know, connect with them and say something nice. And that's always a cool thing to do. So anyway, much love.
Bye, everybody.